In this video, I'm gonna share with you how I created this very artsy type of render. The process includes a bit of rendering settings and a lot of Photoshop. So this video is a little different from the tutorials that we have here on the channel. Like always having the pressure to teach an image or drawing can sometimes limit my creativity. I'm always thinking about how to create something that I can teach you and that will be used in your projects, and I forget about testing new things. So I decided to do it differently now. I've seen some references online and wanted to experiment with this blank space type of render, where you take out the sky and terrain to focus only on the building. But I know the architecture is a result of the surroundings, of the context, of the site, so this type of image may not fit in every scenario, but I imagine testing this with different volumetric or concepts and creating a series of these dreamlike illustrations to help you decide on a new design. Now, if you're new here on the channel, I'm Oliver and I talk about architectural visualization and representation. If you like this type of content, consider subscribing. So in this video, I'll walk you through what I think are the most important moves in an image like this, and I'm pretty sure you'll learn a few things along the way. As always, drop your questions down below, and I usually answer everyone. Now, let's take a look at the process. Okay, so render-wise, this is a super basic render, nothing out of the ordinary, but what really changed the game here and made me get a head start in achieving this endless white space is the setting volumetric environment. Here I used Vray for SketchUp, but it's very likely that any other render engine has this feature. Adding this dense fog to the space can help change the overall mood of the image. And then apart from that, all fairly basic settings, default materials, and then I played a little bit with the sun settings and the shadow direction. But it's over Photoshop that the real work begins. In Photoshop, the first step is masking. And this is the most important step to get this look. I need to remove the sky. This would be an easy task if the fog didn't mess things up. When enabling this fog thing, it bakes the sky into the render, not allowing you to save the PNG image without a background, as I usually do, or even use the alpha channel. That doesn't help either. So what I did was to use the other channels to get the bulk of the sky masked out. And if it weren't for the polycarbonate, this would be done in a split second. But because I used this translucent material and there's a lot of structures behind and in front of it, I had to manually mask some parts out, which, yes, took some time, but there are things that need to be manually done and there's no work around it. So after that's done, I need to start fixing some things, like the building faces were too white. And even though this is a white space, you need to be able to properly see where the faces start and end. So once you have the overall look done, like a white background with white flooring, you need to look at the values. These concrete slabs are definitely too dark. I mean, there's no right or wrong here, but the more experience you have in renderings and post-production, you start noticing these subtle differences. And even though we're talking about a very artistic type of image, this exact step here applies to pretty much any type of rendering. Understanding how to play with values is a vital skill. Okay, so base is done. Now we add the cutouts. You could add the trees directly in 3D, for sure, but for the type of image we're working on, they would maybe look too heavy, you know, too dense, and adding them in post-production gives you more creative flexibility, which I'm going to talk about in just a second. The trick about cutouts, that being people or trees, is to first place all the objects so that you get a good sense of the composition. Then once you're happy with it and feel that it's all balanced out, you can move into adjusting the colors and values to make sure that the cutouts match your scene. In this image, it's quite easy to make them fill in place. I'm just adding a white haze, a white fog above the layer. This obviously will depend on your image, but make sure when you're doing something like this, do it in a new layer. Then here in the folder, I organized one folder for the back trees and one for the ones on the front. I added filters to make them a little bit more orangey. I mean, this is more to fit the overall color palette. And then you can play with the blurriness of the elements. With the trees that are further away, they will look more washed out, yeah, but they can also look blurred compared to the ones close to the camera. And then with people, which we'll do in just a second, you can add motion blur. And if you take a look here, the trees are even blurrier because it's behind the polycarbonate. I think that adds some nice details. And this reminds me of this specific step. Since I had a little bit of trouble masking this out, I kind of lost some of the texture that the polycarbonate has, which are the vertical lines. So using the mask I made earlier by hand, I can draw some vertical lines to mimic the material appearance. Since this one is somewhat far from the camera, little mistakes go unnoticed, so don't get too picky when doing something like this. Focus on the overall look. Now, before adding the shadows, which are going to be very subtle if you notice the shadows that are already in the image. So before that, I'm going to add the people, so then I'll do the shadows all at once. I've talked about this in many videos, but if your scene was done at eye level, which most often they should, just drag a guide over the horizon. This will help you tremendously when adding people. Okay, then for the shadows, I'm going to link a video we have here on the channel that goes really in depth on them, like adding proper shadows, different types of shadows and so on. But since they're so subtle here and we're going for this artistic look, we have a larger mistake margin, if you will. It's just a matter of adding a bit here and there to make them feel like they're touching the floor. And this is really important since we don't have flooring on this image. It's the shadow that will make them feel like there's a plane here and they are actually touching it. On the foreground trees, you can duplicate the layer, make it full black, and then use it as the start to create the shadow. Look, I really like those collages that use a bunch of textures to differentiate the building faces, but this image is too clean and minimal to go all in on that idea, so I only apply to this building here. I googled for watercolor paper and dragged it into Photoshop, and the trick here is to change the blend mode to multiply so that it blends in with the values that already exist on the image. It doesn't have to look too realistic, to be honest. I think the mix of styles is something that can get explored. It's really these small things that adds identity to the image. It makes it truly yours and with your touch. I also found this color palette on Pinterest, and it has such an aesthetically pleasing color scheme that I really wanted to incorporate it into this image, but maybe in the future, because I kind of tried at the beginning here, but since this image has so few colors, it wouldn't really work. Then it's all about the extra things you add to the image. The composition is pretty much ready, but to make it better, to make it more complex in a sense, requires now you to take care of the details, like adding a little bit of foliage on the background to give more depth and stuff like that. Or even using a filter like this, which can be replaced by the camera raw filter. This just adds contrast, enhance the colors, and make it overall stronger. By the way, this one is called Topaz Labs plugin. I've got a really old version that I kept, but again, the camera raw filter achieves the same result with the texture and clarity slider. And I know this is usually the last step, the final move is what I like to call, but sometimes to make everything blend with each other, I like to give a uniform noise to the image, but it's different to just adding noise to the last joint layer. Let me show you how to do this. You first create a new layer, then add a 50% gray fill. And now we add the noise on top of that. 20% here may be too much, so let's go for 10. And now change the blend mode to overlay. And the technical term of this blend mode is that everything that is 50% gray turns transparent, and then everything above it, or that means towards white, gets brightened, and then everything towards black gets darkened. Yes, this is a lot of noise, but I think it looks pretty good. It's strong, but still, I think it fits this style. And as you can see, it kind of ties everything together, doesn't it? Okay, that's it, guys. Again, I want to explore more different things here on the channel. This was actually the channel goal when I started, like me having a place to experiment. So I hope you found this video helpful and learned something new. If you have any suggestions for future videos, please do let me know. I know that portfolios are highly requested, right? So I'll work on them whenever possible. I think I've never done a proper video here on the channel. It's just that portfolios require a lot of drawings on hand. So sometimes that's difficult. And then maybe I was thinking, I could do a portfolio makeover, something like that, where I get one portfolio from you guys and recreate it from scratch. Let me know what you think and if you would be interested. Don't forget that we have courses that teach visualization, diagrams, and plans. So if you want in-depth lessons on how to create these images and drawings, be sure to check the first link in the video description. As always, thanks for watching, and I'll see you guys in the next video.